Have you ever wondered how we've ended up in the current state of cosmology? Let's take a journey with Hannes Alfven through the history of cosmology to understand why it is that we've ended up where we are today and to see that we are repeating the same patterns over and over again. And then lastly, to see the path that Alfven sets out for the future of cosmology. Cosmology started when man began to ask what is beyond the horizon and what happened before the earliest event that I can remember. In ancient time, these questions were answered by asking those who had travelled about the regions they had visited and the people they had encountered. Information was also passed down generation to generation in the form of stories. The problem was that the further the tale had travelled, or the older the story told, the more uncertain the stories became. As time went by, the demand for this knowledge increased, and some people started to appear who claimed to have knowledge of the most distant regions and the earliest times. They claimed that they had gained this knowledge directly from the gods and had been given revelations about the structure of the universe and how it was created. These myths were later incorporated as part of religious traditions. In different cultures, these mythologies became very different. In some, both the gods and the universe were believed to be eternal. And in others, the gods created the universe, and others still, the gods formed the universe from themselves. Indian mythology has developed an intermingling coexistence of beliefs. They believe that the evolution of the universe and the humans is cyclic, and that there was a hierarchy to this. In total, they believe that the universe has existed for 146,000 billion years. In the Mediterranean, their beliefs were initially similar, believing in a series of ages. When the Greek culture started to take off, their beliefs developed along very different paths. Where the Indians had a much grander scale of time, the Greeks could only think in terms of thousands of years. Their idea of the scale of the universe were, however, quite similar. Not all early cosmology was so closely linked to religion. In China, their thinking was based more on observation, and as their ability to observe was limited, they could not draw any meaningful conclusions. Buddhism developed views of cosmology which were drastically different from the other Indian cosmologies. It is an agnostic belief, neither denying or confirming the existence of any gods, believing that the path to salvation is through the annihilation of desire, the state of nirvana. Consequently, they don't really make any firm statements on whether the universe is eternal or not. As the Greek culture started to explode in 500 BC, a new element was introduced from Egypt, geometry. The Greeks developed this to a still unsurpassed level of Euclidean geometry. Connected to this, the Pythagoreans developed the idea that musical harmony could be linked to simple ratios of integers. They also tried to incorporate astronomy and cosmology into their philosophy, claiming that this, to the eye, was what music was to the ears. According to them, the circle was the most perfect geometrical figure, and the sphere was the most perfect of all solid bodies. Therefore, the Earth must be a circular disk or a sphere, surrounded by a number of crystal spheres which held the planets and stars. The most perfect motion was uniform motion, and therefore these spheres must rotate with uniform motion. Unfortunately, the Pythagoreans and Plato never cared much for a comparison with observations, and they were a deeply secret society cut off from mainstream Greek society. They believed that any use of equipment was below them, and their function was only that of thought. This unfortunately held them back from making any scientific breakthroughs, which would come some 2,000 years later in Europe. The notion of these crystal spheres unfortunately did not hold up well with observations, and in particular the motion of the planets. It was suggested that the planets may not be directly fixed to these spheres, and this idea continued with many iterations until eventually the Ptolemaic system was born. It had no less than 54 epicycles, and for a time cosmology became deeply rooted to religion. Criticism of this model was very dangerous. The gods found their homes on these crystal spheres in the form of constellations. The motion of the heavenly bodies was tied into the stories of myths and the gods. These ideas still live on today in the form of astrology. With the rise of monotheistic religion, one god took over from them all. No longer was he part of the universe, instead now being the creator of it. And these new religions could not shake off the old gods. Many transformed the pagan gods, and some became devils, some became saints. Midwinter solstice was, in pagan times, the festival of the sun god, and a fertility moon goddess was worshipped at the full moon after the venerable equinox. And these old traditions remain even today, but in a modified way. Astrology, mythology, and religion formed an increasingly complex structure. The conflict between the old belief that destiny was governed by the stars and the all-powerful God was addressed simply as follows. Stars rule men, but gods rule stars. And the idea that the stars moved according to certain mathematical principles was forgotten. Long before Galileo, new ideas had appeared in Islamic culture. In the 12th century, Averroes claimed that the world is eternal, not created, but in a state of evolution. They also viewed the idea of logic and reason to understand all as flawed. They saw a much greater role for cosmology to be based on observation. 200 years later, Copernicus came with a model which would place the sun at the center of the universe, with the planets orbiting around it. And this model would later be abandoned in favor of a galactic-centered model. The real change that the Copernicus model introduced was the notion that observations would lead discovery. Indeed, Bertrand Russell states, "Mathematics is a science in which you never know what you're talking about, nor if what you're saying is true. It deals with the hypothetical entities and is only concerned with a relationship to each other, being indifferent to whether anything in the real world corresponds." Alfven goes on to actually state, "This means that the mathematics is suitable to give prestige to any idea, but if the idea is myth, mathematics can turn it into a mathematical myth, but not guarantee that it is anything to do with reality." And this very much reminds me of the position that cosmology finds itself in today, with its over-reliance on mathematics rather than observation. The observational approach in the introduction of the telescope led to a wealth of data, and this led both Kepler and Newton to formulate new laws of nature to account for these observations. One of the most important changes to come out of this was the abolishment of the difference between the physics of the heaven and the physics of the mundane. Newton showed that the falling of the apple and the motion of the moon were all due to the same phenomenon. The success of the Copernican model was largely down to Galileo's telescope and the observational data. In fact, Aristarchus had proposed the same theory 2,000 years earlier, but there were no telescopes, so it could not be proved. At the beginning of the 20th century, Newton's ideas were challenged in four different respects. Number one, it was obvious that it was not applicable to atoms, where it had to be replaced by quantum mechanics. Number two, motions with velocities which were not negligible in comparison to the speed of light must be treated by special relativity. Number three, the general theory of relativity required the three-dimensional Euclidean space of Newton to be replaced with four-dimensional curved space. Number four, it became obvious that electromagnetic phenomena were of decisive importance for the motion of the ionized diffuse media, and it was necessary to introduce magnetohydrodynamics and plasma physics into cosmological physics. Both Kepler and Tycho Brahe were both astronomers and astrologers, and saw no conflict in this. Newton himself once stated that his celestial mechanics proved the existence of God, and he spent his old age calculating how many angels there were according to the apocalypse. It took more than two centuries for the early success of celestial mechanics to spread into biology. The scientific approach now embraces the origin of life and the functioning of the human brain. However, this does not mean a total victory for the scientific method. In reality, we witness an anti-scientific attitude and the revival of myth. In his paper, Alfven refers to the growth of creationism across America. But equally today, there is also a growing movement of flat earthers who shirk the common sense approach. Interestingly, he also refers to part of the problem being that science has become so powerful that it has released a sort of scientific creationism into academia. One of the most beautiful results of science is the special theory of relativity. It was essentially based on the Michelson-Morley experiment and on Maxwell's theory of electromagnetism. When expressed in three dimensions, special relativity has an elegance which is only surpassed by expressing it in four dimensions. The problem was, from a mathematical point of view, this was all very elegant, but from a physical point of view, it added nothing new. From this point on, bestsellers in popular science books were those that presented their results as an insult to common sense. Science became something to believe in, not something which should be understood. In general relativity, the four-dimensional formulation is more important than in special relativity. This made it far more dangerous, as mathematicians and cosmologists with little contact with empirical reality took hold. Many of these scientists do not know what a laboratory is and have never looked through a telescope. They accepted the Pythagorean way of working, to concentrate on the theoretical side of their subject and not spend endless trouble over physical measurements. They looked down on observers and experimenters whose only job was to confirm their highbrow conclusions. And if they failed to find evidence of their conclusions, they were thought to be incompetent. General relativity paved the way for a second era of Pythagorean thinking. We were back to believing that we could explore the universe purely mathematically. The cosmological discussion became monopolized by Big Bang believers, who had studied general relativity for years. Only the observations that supported their ideas were mentioned, and those that disagreed were swept under the rug. Take Halton Arp as a case in point here. Alfven then goes on to discuss the main, in quotes, evidence for the Big Bang and some of the observations which point to a big problem with the Big Bang. And in order to solve these problems, scientists have had to concoct more ad hoc, elaborate and fanciful solutions, as we have discussed in a number of previous videos. And this is all very reminiscent of the Ptolemaic epoch and the introduction of more and more epicycles to explain the motion of the planets. And there is only one piece of evidence that the Big Bang believers seriously claim provides evidence for their cosmology, and that is the cosmic background radiation. And Alfven goes on to discuss the problem with extrapolating the temperature from now back in time to assume that it was billions of degrees hotter before, when it was 10 to the 27 times smaller. And we have also previously discussed some of the glaring problems with the cosmic microwave background radiation data. But Alfven adds one more interesting addition. He speculates that needle-shaped conducting grains can provide sufficient capacity to produce the observed spectrum. Although these grains have never been detected, it would account for the interstellar polarization of light. A very important conclusion from the Big Bang cosmology is that the state at the singularity point necessarily presupposes a divine creation. However, most Big Bang believers would prefer to sweep creation under the rug. In fact, they fight against popular creationism, and at the same time, they fight fanatically for their own creationism. So, are there alternatives to the Big Bang? Indeed, there are, although they are seldom mentioned by any mainstream book or in any science classroom. One of the most interesting alternatives is the hierarchical cosmology. And here the universe is infinite with a hierarchical structure. And the idea actually predates both the Big Bang and general relativity. Inspired by Fourier, Charlier demonstrates that in order to avoid the Olbers and Seelinger objections to a Euclidean infinite universe, it is necessary that the universe is clumpy, with a hierarchical matter distribution. Stars are organized into galaxies and galaxies into clusters of galaxies, and these clusters into yet larger clusters, and so on ad infinitum. And we have discussed something similar when we looked at ARP's cosmology. Another drastic change in our approach to cosmology came with the realization of the importance of the electrodynamic effects to the motion of dispersed media. Because the electromagnetic force is 10 to the 39 times greater than the gravitational force, they will dominate the dynamics in all cases when the number of positive to negative ions is not balanced. And as we have seen in Plasma Simply Explained, it really only takes a few small differences for this to start acting. In fact, hydromagnetic and plasma phenomena dominate in 99.99% of the universe compared to gravity. Through our probes into space, we have uncovered that the universe is in fact filled with plasma and has meant a large revision to large parts of cosmic physics. Number one, electric AAs and their ability to accelerate charged particles to relativistic speeds, creating cosmic rays. Number two, cosmic plasmas are often not homogeneous, but exhibit filamentary structures and associated filamentary current. Number three, in the magnetosphere, there are thin, rather stable current layers which separate regions of different magnetization, density, and temperature. Number four, it is difficult to avoid the conclusion that similar phenomena exist also in more distant regions, and this is bound to give space a general cellular structure. Number five, the arguments for the non-existence of antimatter in the cosmos are not valid. There are sound arguments for the existence of antimatter, which means that annihilation should be considered an important source of energy. Number six, radio X-ray and gamma ray emissions and cosmic ray acceleration are largely due to plasma processes and would require considerable revision to these areas of cosmology. These sciences must ultimately be based on the observed properties of laboratory and magnetosphere plasma. The Big Bang should yield a homogeneous universe, and attempts to explain the non-homogeneous observations have resulted in the creation of dark matter to explain this clumping. The more we observe our universe, the more we are seeing this clumping. 4 millennia of cosmology has resulted in 3 different approaches. Number one, the scientific approach, based on empirical facts, observation, and experimentation. Number two, the agnostic approach. How can we know about, or why should we care about, a problem so distant? Number three, the mythological approach. The theoretical thinker's approach. Someone with greater understanding than you has calculated that it is so, therefore it is. I hope you have enjoyed this journey through cosmology from the perspective of Hannes Alfven. Now, I'll be coming back to some more of Hannes Alfven's work in future episodes, because I think there's a lot to be taken out from what he says. But for me, this whole piece certainly reminds us of where we are today in cosmology and the things that we need to try and avoid, both from in terms of mainstream, but I would equally argue as well within the electric universe. There is a danger that we become too complacent in thinking that what we have is correct, and I think it is important for us to always remember that we need to go back to first principle, the data, the observation, and the facts. And it's no good arguing that someone else's theory is rubbish because they haven't done those things. It is up to us to provide the evidence to support our theory, as Galileo did with his telescopes. observation is king. I hope that you can see the relationship between some of Hannes Alfven's views and some of the things that we've been talking about over the course of, well, we're now up to 31 videos so far. As always, be brave, be curious. The truth is waiting for us. Until next time.